Hi guys, today we're going to talk about brains and quadcopters. Let's start with brains. In the late 1950s, Hubel and Wiesel conducted their Nobel Prize winning experiments in the visual cortex of the brain. In their experiment, they had a cat look at a screen. The screen had a bar of light on it that they could move around and resize. While the cat looked at the screen, they recorded electrical activity from the visual cortex of the cat's brain. If we were to zoom in to their recording site, you would see something like this. Here is a neuron, and here is an electrode recording the electrical activity from that neuron. Here is what the cat sees during the experiment. Recall that the bar of light will move around and change sizes. While the bar moves around, pay attention to the sounds that you hear. What you will hear is the recorded electrical activity of the neuron in visual cortex fed to a speaker. You can literally listen in on the neuron's activity while the cat looks at the screen. Okay, besides the fact that it's mind-blowingly cool that you can listen in on the activity of individual neurons in the brain, you might have noticed that the neuron only responds to the bar of light in a certain area of the field of view, and only responds when the bar is oriented at a certain direction. If you didn't notice these facts because it was just so cool to hear the neuron's spiking activity, just go back and rewatch the experiment. And keep in mind that there are some neurons in your own brain that are responding similarly to this video as the cat's neuron is to the bar of light. Let's move on from their experiment to having a look at their experiment's data. The left column shows the angle of the bar of light, and the right column shows the neuron's response to the bar of light over time, where time progresses from left to right along the horizontal line in each row. This small bar represents the time in which the stimulus was on and inside the region of the visual field that the neuron was responsive to. Each one of these vertical tick marks represents a neuron's spike, which was that popping sound you heard during the experiment. For example, in the trial where the bar was horizontal, the neuron was quiet, whereas in the trial where the bar was just off vertical, the neuron spiked 7 times during the stimulus presentation. Now, if we were to divide the number of spikes by the amount of time that the stimulus was present and get a spike rate for each bar orientation, we would get a plot like this, which we could fit a curve to. This curve describes the neuron's output spike rate as a function of some input stimulus, otherwise known as its tuning curve. Now, the idea of an input-output relationship is pretty general, so don't get too attached to this particular neuron and this particular tuning curve. You might find tuning curves that look like this, or this, or this, or this if you're into deep learning, or tuning curves that are functions of multiple dimensions like this, or that even change over time. In fact, recall that the cat's neuron responded not only to the bar's orientation, but also to the position of the bar in the field of view. So our description of the neuron's tuning was already simplified down to a single dimension, even though we know that the neuron is responsive to multiple aspects of the visual field. Now, remember that the neuron is sitting in the salty bath of your brain. We're not shining the bar of light directly on the neuron, so it of course has no idea that it's responding to the bar of light's orientation, which brings us back to the experiments of Hubel and Wiesel. What won them the Nobel Prize was more than just finding some tuning curves. Rather, they also proposed specific neural circuits that showed how signals flowed from cells in the retina to cells in the lateral geniculate nucleus to cells in the primary visual cortex. They showed how the tuning of one layer of neurons could give rise to the tuning of the next layer of neurons through a specific set of connectivity. So this has been a lot of neuroscience, and I'm leaving out a lot of details, and there's much more neuroscience out there, but we won't go there, at least not in this video, because quadcopter. I said quadcopter in the beginning, let's do tuning curves on a quadcopter. Here is a quadcopter. Inside this copter, I have an Omnibus F3 flight control board, and I have it talking to this Raspberry Pi. The Pi's job is going to be to simulate neurons that are attuned to the roll angle of the copter. Let's go outside. Here's what the quadcopter sees. This quadcopter has 2 neurons attuned to the vehicle's roll angle. Here is a plot of their tuning curves. Neuron 0 fires more in response to counterclockwise roll angles, while neuron 1 fires more in response to clockwise roll angles. Here will be a plot of the neuron's spiking activity over time. In the cat video, we only listened to a single neuron. Here, we are going to listen to 2 neurons simultaneously. Pay attention to when neurons spike and don't spike. Hopefully, you noticed that indeed the neurons were responsive to the roll angle, but not to the pitch or yaw angles. If you didn't catch any of this, just go back and rewatch the maneuvers. These roll neurons would be akin to the neurons in your inner ear, which similarly respond to your head rotation, and give rise to your sense of balance. We could, of course, also set up neurons attuned to the pitch or yaw angles as well. Now, let's go fly the quadcopter. In this flight, I hope you agree that the neurons behave just like they did on the ground. So where do we go from here? At this point, we've set up neurons on a quadcopter that can act as a first layer of computation. In a future video, we can talk about how these spiky neurons can be used in a useful manner. If you want to read ahead, you can look up something called the Neural Engineering Framework. Otherwise, let me know in the comments if you have any other questions. Thank you for watching!